Let me first introduce our guests to you. Now, you can see on the table there their names, but we'll start at this end. This is Professor Jeff King, and he is from the University College London. He's been a senior lecturer there since 2011 and professor of law since last year. And he's co-editor of the UK Constitutional Law blog and the treasurer of the UK Constitutional Law Association. So anything on the Constitution? I think it's going to the end there. Next we have Tasmina Ahmed-Sheikh, the MP, who's been in the Scottish National Party MP since May 2015 and is currently the SNP's trade and investment spokesman and the deputy shadow leader of the House in the House of Commons. Now, moving along, we have Seb Dance, MP. MEP, apologies, Seb, yeah, a Labour MEP for London, serving on the Committee for the Environment, Public Health and Food Safety, and also Committee on Development. You've worked for development charity ActionAid as well. Yeah. And Baroness Ludford, to my left. Now, Baroness Ludford is a qualified barrister and graduate of the LSE and a member of the House of Lords for the Liberal Democrats. So you're feeling a bit tired, I'm sure. So, of course, you all know that...
We've got 12 hours to go today.
you all know that second reading is going through the Lords at the moment. So, interesting times all around, and we're sort of paused at a crossroads, really, aren't we, between the Brexit debate in the Commons, now the second reading in the Lords, and the Article 50 being triggered itself. So what we're going to do is we're going to give all of the speakers around 7 minutes each to state their case or their thoughts on the issues. And as I said, two of our guests have to leave early. So we're going to start with Baroness Ludford.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Maxine, and thank you very much for inviting me this morning. I'm not sure I thought that at 2 o'clock last night or this morning. When I thought, oh, did I really agree to be at something at 9 o'clock? Anyway, it's, of course, a great pleasure to be here and a pleasure to be with the other people on this panel. I think I'm only meeting Seb for the first time. We sort of see each other on Twitter, and have to admit, I was impressed by his recent holding up of a sign. I don't know, have you had your wrist slapped by the powers that be, Seb?
I have, yes.
What
yes.
happened?
It was a very polite conversation with the President of the Parliament.
Oh, right, very good.
To whom I apologise for breaking the rules but not the message.
Yes, indeed, indeed. And we've seen, I'm afraid, other examples of that tendency of that particular party in Stoke on Trent Central. I'm partisan, as you can see. It's also a pleasure to meet Jeff again because his co-authorship of an article last July, on pulling the Article 50 trigger, Parliament's indispensable role, is probably why I am sitting through 21 hours of second reading of the Article 50 bill. And, I mean, you know, I'm grateful to all the academic and legal and other commentators for all the assistance they've given in the last 8 months or so. I think my view is that whether legally, politically or constitutionally, it was... absolutely apparent that the government had to take Parliament seriously after the referendum vote and to spend the best part of 6 months in litigating to stop the implementation of the very parliamentary sovereignty that the Leave campaign was supposedly fought in the name of. Was frankly outrageous. And so we give rather short shrift when the government now says, oh, the Lords must not delay the Article 50 bill. First of all, we're not going to delay it. But secondly, the government itself is responsible for months and months of unnecessary delay. I mean, you know, when you think about it, it's absurd that a campaign fought about taking back control, and one of those controls was national parliamentary sovereignty, should apparently mean that Parliament has no sovereignty whatsoever. So that's just one of the many absurdities of the situation that we are in. I think that my experience in the European Parliament, where I was for 15 years, probably shapes a little bit how I think about this, because you'll be aware that the government, in the person of David Davis, has pledged to treat the European, it's in now in the white paper, I think, has pledged to treat the Westminster Parliament no less well than the European Parliament in terms of sort of scrutiny arrangements. Well, that promise was elicited by my colleague, Robin Teverson, who is a member of the EU Select Committee, and he's a Lib Dem colleague of mine, also a former MEP. So, like me, he was conscious of the powers of the sort of continuing dialogue that the European Parliament has over the negotiation process. And I think that those arrangements, I mean, I'm not very good at rules, I have to admit, so I'm not the world's expert on what the interinstitutional agreement consists of, but it was shaped by realisation by the Council that the European Parliament had the nuclear bomb in the terms of rejecting agreements at the end, which when during my time we did at least two of them. And so the Parliament thought, aha, maybe we ought to involve these guys a little earlier in the process to try and avoid that they press the nuclear button at the end. And so that's what accounts, really, for the front-loading of the parliamentary involvement in Brussels. So, really, I think whatever sort of detail of arrangements you lay down, that's the sort of principle, really, that you need to have a full an honest partnership between the executive and the parliament to, well, partly it's just the right thing to do, but also it avoids sort of blow-ups at the end. And I think the government would have been advised, well advised, to start on that foot last July and not to have this unnecessary, if riveting, litigation that ended up in the Supreme Court, which, you know, took up a lot of your money. So they should have said, yes, of course, it's just self-evident that Parliament must be treated properly. Just a couple of other things to say. One of the things, and I just refreshed my memory by looking at the summary of the article that Jeff and his colleagues wrote last year. He said that Parliament should have the final say. I would amend that to the people, and I'll just come to that in a second. Final say on the implications of the referendum. I think that's a good way of putting it, because we're being faced by endless Tories in the Lords at the moment who are saying, you are defying the will of the people. To which our response is, well, the people voted last year for departure, they didn't vote for destination. You've probably heard this endlessly from Tim Farron and people. But I think that's absolutely right. I mean, what is Parliament for but to try and put some flesh on the bones of a popular decision? Otherwise, there's no point in having parliaments at all. You just have direct democracy. And I think it's quite interesting that it's Conservatives who are almost, you know, talking about working Parliament out of a job. Because they've never been in the business of sort of popular sovereignty. They've talked about parliamentary sovereignty. But now what they're really saying is there is a complete straight line from the decision last year to us failing, exiting out of the EU, with really no role for Parliament whatsoever. But I see it more as a sort of relay between Parliament and the people. It was party political pledge by the Tory party to have the referendum. Parliament then sets the parameters of that in the Referendum Act, rightly or wrongly. So people have a vote. Parliament then has to consider, and then Jeff's turn, the implications of that referendum. And we are perfectly within our rights and would be abrogating our responsibility just to take what the government says, which in the Liberal Democrat contention is the most extreme of all the choices available to it. Out of the single market, out of the customs union, you know, prepared, in Theresa May's word, that no deal is better than a bad deal. Just think about that. No deal. For a Prime Minister to contemplate this cliff edge crashing out is deeply irresponsible in our view. But it is just crazy to think that Parliament just sits on its hands and does and says nothing. We have a duty to tease out where is the government going? How is it proposing to implement the results of the referendum and Brexit? And then we would say pass the results of that. So Parliament then sort of, if you like, sets the parameters of the negotiations, gets to vote on the finality of those negotiations, and then passes back to the people to say, do you like? It should be your decision whether you like the output of all that reflection, evaluation, and negotiation. Do you like that compared to European Union membership status quo that we have at the moment? So it's, if you like, I mean, as we started off, okay, lots of people don't like referenda, and I've got many colleagues in my group who don't. But if we started this by a referendum last year, if you, in the words of one of my colleagues, if you start with democracy, you shouldn't end up with a stitch-up. So it needs to go back to the people for the final say on the Brexit deal.
Thank you very much. And just to point out that Baroness Ludford is going to have the final say in the debate, aren't you?
No, the third final.
Third final say.
Final for the Lib Dems, then Labour wind, and then the government.
Are you looking
forward
to that?
The Minister. Ask me at 1 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Okay, we've been joined by our final panel member. Were you stuck on the tube as well? Probably. Dr. Davor Jancic from Queen Mary University in London. He has a PhD in European Constitutional Law, and his doctorate analysed the role of national parliaments in EU decision-making. So we're very glad you made it. And I just want to point out, people always ask, what are the make-ups of these panels and how do we get these people to persuade them to come and talk to us, and how do we get the makeup of it? So we're really grateful for everybody who's come along today, and we've got a really good, extensive panel. However, just to give you a flavour of who else was invited, because extensive efforts are made to get a good crossbody for these panels. So I'm going to give you a quick list. Invited 4 Conservative MPs, Theresa Villiers, Penny Mordaunt, Maria Caulfield, and Andrea Jenkins. 2 from Labour, Gisela Stewart and Kate Hoey. 2 UKIP members from the Welsh Assembly, Michelle Brown and Caroline Jones. So that's quite a bit of a spread. However, they were all either unavailable, unwilling, or they actually didn't respond to the invitation. So it just gives you a flavour that there is a real spread of invites goes out there. However, of course, we have the best of the bunch.
Anyway. We're not just here because they said no. That's
no, you're not just feeling a seat. It's open. Don't worry. Okay, so
cheer them.
No. They'd find it hard to get to the bar here. So, Tasmina Ahmed-Sheikh.
Thank you very much indeed, and good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here. I think, like probably some in the panel and many in the room, I kind of wish that 2016 and the 2 momentous decisions that were taken here and across the waters would just go away. And we'll all wake up and it'll be a terribly bad dream. Unfortunately, that is not the case. And given we have such a breadth of excellence across the panel, it's probably appropriate that I speak mostly about Scotland and Scotland's position in all of this to give you an insight as to where we are. Apart from Baroness Ludford, who's also going through the motions in the House of Lords, we have tried to embrace this process as much as we possibly can. And if I take you through sort of the night, that fateful night last year, 23rd of June, I was just due to go on Adam Bolton Sky about 4 a.m, just waiting for the last Scottish local authority to declare what their votes were. And then we found out that every single local authority in Scotland had voted to remain in the EU, whilst the rest of the UK, apart from Northern Ireland, of course, had voted to come out. It was that moment in time where you just weren't sure what that meant for you, your future, your country. And it was rather a nerve-wracking and a nervous moment. And then, as you'll all remember, there was kind of a deadly silence for a couple of days. And I'm very proud, regardless of anyone's politics, that Nicola Sturgeon was the first to come off the blocks and address people and say what her view was, what she felt as the leader of the Scottish Government, and indeed give EU nationals who are so important to the fabric of our society, not just from an economic perspective, but as a BME woman of mixed race, we must always acknowledge and welcome the contribution culturally people from the EU make to our country as well. It's not just about money, but she was out there saying that they are welcome and always will, and she would fight for EU nationals to remain, and that has remained the case. We then, I shall know that Nicola Sturgeon was Theresa May's first port of call after the EU referendum. And during that meeting, which was largely constructive, she did speak about a UK-wide approach to negotiations. Unfortunately, what's happened in the House of Commons has demonstrated that that is absolutely not going to be the case. And you'll be aware that we have Scotland's plan, Scotland's place in Europe. And that's a three-point plan that the Scottish Government have presented to the Joint Committee, indeed to the Prime Minister, to look at. We haven't had an answer yet in relation to their view on Scotland's suggestions as to how we think we should move forward. If the Prime Minister wants to avoid what could possibly be a constitutional crisis. Now, remaining in the EU is Scotland's preferred position, always will be, as full members of the European Union. However, in the spirit of trying to speak for all of Scotland and engage with the whole of the United Kingdom, we put forward 3 points. The first one was, our wish was that the whole of the UK remain in the single market. Now, for reasons best known to the Prime Minister, she decided to ditch that very early on in her speech in January. Quite why you would do that before even entering negotiations in the EU, I simply don't understand. Then, of course, there's been discussions about the customs union and our position in that respect also seems to be on a knife edge. So that was our option number one. Let's all stay in the single market to keep the UK together for now. The second option was, of course, that there is a differentiated agreement for Scotland, bearing in mind that Scotland voted 62% to stay within the EU. We'd worked out via the Fraser Valander Institute that leaving the single market means a loss of 80,000 jobs in Scotland at £2,000 per head per year. That's how huge it is for the economy in Scotland. And the EU is our biggest export growth market. So we said we want a differentiated deal for Scotland, like there is likely to be one for the City of London, albeit at a cost. We know we'll need to pay in for that. And these are things that the Prime Minister has spoken of in the House of Commons. And also, as we know, a differentiated deal for not one now, but it seems to be two car manufacturers as well. So why not for Scotland? Because if you're going to talk about negotiating for the whole of the United Kingdom, surely you should listen to all of the voices that constructively make up the UK. We are yet to hear back from the Prime Minister in that respect, but I think that decision is going to be forthcoming shortly. What that means then for Scotland and Scotland's First Minister is whether part three of the proposal is invoked or not. And part three is, of course, that the First Minister of Scotland and her government has a mandate. If we are taken a mandate, popular mandate by the people, it's a manifesto pledge upon which we stood in 2016 where we won the election, that if we're to be taken out of the EU against our will, we deserve the right to hold another independence referendum and be our own nation state within the EU. So those are our three positions. And what happens very much is based on what the Prime Minister and her government's approach is going to be. But the Scottish Government and their officials, Mike Russell, has approached all meetings really constructively. Those of you who will be following this will have sensed a sense of frustration that things don't seem to be going anywhere when they need to be moving in a positive direction. So that's where Scotland's position is. What happened in the House of Commons is we were presented with a bill. The government didn't want, of course, to bring a bill before Parliament. They spent lots of money trying not to be in that position and then waxed lyrical about how it was great for democracy that we were having this debate. Those of you that watch me would have noticed that I had to bat away many Tories along the way that tried to shout me down, so often the case if you're a woman speaking in Parliament nowadays, when I was trying to remind them of the situation, that they tried to avoid that at all costs. They were forced into producing a white paper just days before we had the debate in Parliament. What does that speak to? It speaks exactly what Baroness Ludford was saying. Government is trying to rally and reel everything through without consulting with people who genuinely have been elected by people and have something meaningful to add to the debate. The SNP put down 50 amendments to Article 50, and every single one of our amendments, and indeed every other party's amendments that were tabled, were rejected by the government. It is quite a ridiculous situation in which we find ourselves. That are we really saying, as a country, that Parliament of 650 MPs and all of the amendments we put together were meaningless? There was nothing in there that could add to a constructive deal to moving the UK forward in such difficult circumstances? Nothing at all? But that's what the government said to us by voting them all down. And that, I suppose, speaks to some of the comments that have been made to the House of Lords in their dealings. And I do hope something positive can come out of the House of Lords, specifically in relation to EU nationals. And secondly, a clause that was very important to us, which was what we named it, the reset clause. This idea that after 2 years we'll have a vote on the final deal is irrelevant. It's a fait accompli. You've invoked Article 50. You're out after 2 years. Game over. I'm not prepared to put my faith in this government that they can negotiate any deal at all, let alone a good deal. So what we suggested was, if it's the case that the government cannot negotiate a deal that's acceptable to the parliamentarians that will vote for it, we should be able to revert to as we currently are until a deal can be negotiated that is acceptable. So that was our view. I'm going to finish my remarks on that and don't want to speak any further and take anyone else's time. But I just want you to understand uniquely Scotland's position. We're not trying to be difficult. We're simply trying to play to the rules that the Prime Minister laid out that she would play the game by in terms of Scotland, failing which we cannot be blamed for doing our best to ensure that the will of the people of Scotland is adhered to. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to thank Baroness Ludford for very kind comments and salute Tasmin Ahmed-Sheikh for standing up to everyday sexism in Parliament. That was really wonderful. So the crucial issue that I will focus on as you're in Europe House Council today is the role of Westminster and indirectly any devolved parliament or government in the UK, the role that they would have on negotiations towards an exit agreement. And the key point here is the role during negotiations, not after. I'll discuss that here and how it compares internationally. So I'll start by observing that the conventional position in the UK is that Parliament has no role during negotiations. Historically, Parliament was involved after, at the end, under the Ponsonby Rule, which is a constitutional convention established in the 20s, that fully negotiated treaties would be laid before Parliament and subject to a resolution. A variant of that rule continues to exist under the Constitutional Reform and Governance Act of 2010. Now, we have to look at the reasons for that traditional rule. Traditionally, foreign treaties could not affect the law of the land. So the idea was that if the law of the land were changed, that would have to be Parliament. That's why you could allow the Crown to do what it wanted. But there was another reason, which is that the conduct of international relations was considered to be an area which had to be left in the hands of the Crown. The reason was given by Blackstone, a famous jurist. This was quoted in the Supreme Court case. He says that this power is wisely placed in a single hand by the British Constitution for the sake of unanimity, strength, and dispatch. You didn't want parliamentary rancor stopping the government from having a strong position. Now, my own view is that that view espoused by Blackstone and espoused by the current government is outmoded. Blackstone wrote at a time where democracy was completely unrecognizable to the one that we have now. It was a time when even Cromwell couldn't unite Parliament and had to abolish it. We're in a different situation now, as I'll explain shortly. But I want to add, this position that parliaments are normally excluded from treaty negotiations is not unique to the United Kingdom. It is the norm internationally. However, there are notable exceptions to that norm. Some countries do provide for involvement of legislatures or subnational units of government in the treaty negotiation process. For instance, in Switzerland, and here I want to credit the researchers who helped me on this, Mr. Connor Crummy and Mr. Eugenio Velasco, doctoral researchers at UCL, for outstanding assistance. So in Switzerland, the cantons are involved and consulted on any international affairs that could affect their competence. In Portugal, under the Constitution, the Parliament has a right to be involved in treaty negotiations. In the United States, the Senate must approve treaties, and it can add conditions to the approval. It can send the President back with an amended text to go negotiate with other partners. These are powers we don't have. Most notably, the European Parliament has a new procedure adopted under the Lisbon Treaty in 2009 and fleshed out since, which provides an extensive code which essentially enables the European Parliament to be notified by the European Commission of any position that they're going to take, to be informed of that position, to be given time to comment on it, and to be told by the Commission whether it has taken adequate account of the European Parliament's recommendations. The Parliament will issue from time to time resolutions. So in the negotiation of TTIP, for instance, the European Parliament issued a text with resolution, a dozen pages of recommendations. Now, that is the gold standard for parliamentary involvement in treaty negotiation. It's particularly relevant now because in the UK, the Lords EU Scrutiny Committee managed to get a concession from the Brexit Secretary, David Davis, that the information that would be supplied to the Westminster Parliament would be on par with the information provided by the European Commission to the European Parliament. That's the extent of the undertaking. There's an excellent report by this EU Scrutiny Committee. It's the fourth report of 2016-17 that was published in October last year. There's also a reply by the Brexit Secretary to the committee, a letter published on the 20th of December, 2016. The commitment that is contained in that discussion before the committee, in that reply by David Davis to the committee, and in the Brexit white paper just published this month, is plain, that the Westminster Parliament is entitled to receive information that is no less significant than what the European Parliament receives. I think that's a significant concession. But it should be noted here that the concession is a political one. Nowhere is it contained in any statute. And at the moment, one of the amendments tabled by the spokesman for the Labour Party in the Lords is to make the role for the Westminster Parliament part of the notification bill. And I think it will be interesting to see how this develops. I'm sure the argument will be by the government that there's no need to put that in a statute and it will complicate things because the political commitment has already been given. The question really is this bare commitment to provide information that is no less than what the European Parliament will provide enough under the circumstances? There's already evidence that the chair of the EU Scrutiny Committee thinks that it's not enough, that it's oblique, as it was mentioned in the debate yesterday. My own view is that it ought to be put into the legislation. Because to rely on executive grace at a time like this, at a time when there will be enormous debate, an enormous political pressure coming from various directions, to shortchange Parliament and the information it receives will be almost unbearable. So there's one other issue that I would like to mention before I pass on the microphone, which is that one option that the EU committee considered but didn't recommend is that the committee ought to have the power that is called scrutiny reserve. The scrutiny reserve power is when the committee can insist that the government of the United Kingdom will not agree any position internationally until the committee has had a time to report on that issue and the government can consider that report. Now, the EU committee refused to recommend that position to the government. The government has made clear that it will not empower the Lords to do that. I think, for reasons I can elaborate on later, that that was a mistake. It would improve the accountability function to insert that power. At the very least, it would be good to have that function in respect of certain issues that are very important. So I think, to sum up, my view is that the suite of rights that Parliament has to comment on the process, if they do in fact look like what is available to the European Parliament, will be impressive, it will be wholly appropriate. The question is whether we've secured them adequately through the undertakings that have now been given. And I'll leave it there.
Jeff, thanks very much indeed. Seb Dance, MEP.
Thank you very much. I'm conscious. Sorry, I'm just setting a timer. So Brexit being my no, not at all. Brexit being my favourite topic.
Have you got a countdown to Brexit?
Gosh, can you imagine? I don't know what would happen. I think the phone would kind of explode. I'm conscious that we have some very expert constitutional experts, and I'm aware that I'm here to give a perspective, which I will, of the European Parliament and the kind of process going forward. Incidentally, thank you to Europe House for hosting today and for making the point very clearly that the European Parliament is one of the parliamentary representations that we have at UK level, namely, of course, the other two being represented here, the House of Commons and the House of Lords. Please never forget the European Parliament, and I'll outline why we are particularly important in this process. But on the politics, I think you're going to have a lot of agreement here, obviously, amongst the three politicians on the panel. And I can't help but make this point as well. Tasmina made the point about Scotland excellently, and when the process began and the Prime Minister said, you know, we were going to have a UK-wide approach, I took a lot of heart from that, actually, and her visit to Edinburgh was a very visible sign that she was intending to take this process out to the other nations and regions of the UK to say, we are going to involve you in this discussion. But Baroness Ludford and I have had the privilege of representing London in the European Parliament. And of course, London also voted to remain. I'm annoyed that we just missed the 62% that Scotland secured, but both of us were blown away, of course, by the Gibraltar result, which was 94%. Though some parts...
Must do better.
It must do better, indeed. But the point here, of course, is that it's Scotland, it's London, it's Northern Ireland, it's Gibraltar, it's also the English cities. Mm-hmm. Bristol, Liverpool, Manchester, Exeter. You know, these are Cardiff. These are cities with huge networks that benefit, of course, from the networks that are available at a European level, but they are centres of excellence. They are hubs of creativity, of industry, and all of these things are at risk. Let's be honest, they're at risk. And I know we're not here to discuss the pros and cons of Brexit, and I'll do my very best to steer myself away from it, but I just can't help myself. And this, of course, means that we do need to have a national discussion which involves everybody who is affected by this decision. And it just beggars belief, I think, the series of decisions that the government has taken to get us to the situation where we are now. The most prominent was, of course, this fight through the courts to try and stop any discussion of this at a parliamentary level. It's bizarre. It's frankly bizarre. I mean, advisory referendum, okay, you know, political question there in whether or not you can not follow through the results of an advisory referendum, but at the very least, you take it to your national parliament, especially when the margin of victory was so slight. We are a country fairly evenly divided. The difference, of course, between the Remain vote and the Leave vote is not that big. And this does warrant a further discussion, but we are where we are. And as Tasmina said, I think there were some sensible, and as Baroness Ludford has said, there are some sensible positions that could be taken if you take the decision to leave the European Union. I think the single market is the most obvious step, even if it's a transition to something else. It seems to me to be an obvious step to take. But the government has made their decision. They've made their decision before they've even got to the negotiation table, and they've made that decision without the consultation that they promised at the beginning of the process. So I think we have a right to be fairly teed off with the way in which this is progressing. But I am aware we are where we are. As much as I would love this to all go away, it's not going to. And frankly, nor should it. We have had a very extensive discussion about what our membership of the European Union looks like and what the options available to us are, and no one is in any position to ignore it. That includes the government, but as I say, they're ignoring one side of it so far. So what happens now in terms of the European Parliament? Very interesting to hear from Professor King about the access to information that the House of Commons and House of Lords will have. One thing that's often not recognised in the discussion that we have in this country is that we talk a lot about ourselves to ourselves, and we ignore the fact that there is going to be a discussion about this, not just between ourselves on the preferred options that the UK would want to see, but of course the EU27. And the EU27 are not saying very much by way of detail in terms of what their negotiation position will be, although there are several documents that have been produced, most notably within the parliamentary committees on the European Parliament, that have given an indication of what that negotiation process will look like. But they are keeping their cards very close to their chest, and they're doing so for one very simple reason, that until Article 50 is officially notified, until the letter is sent from the government to the Commission, this discussion, if you like, is all theoretical. The UK leaving the European Union is, in effect, theoretical. It's a political discussion. It's not a constitutional discussion yet. That will, of course, change by the end of next month when the letter is submitted. From that point, the European Parliament will then have to draw up a position. It will be a resolution, as you mentioned, which will outline some of the positions that the Parliament will say are red lines and non-negotiable, in effect, which will then be presented to the Commission. The Parliament doesn't have an official negotiating role, but Parliament does have the ability to veto the deal at the end of the process, and it's because of that that the Commission will want to take into account what the Parliament says. If that deal is voted down, of course, at the end of this process, 18 months from the beginning of the negotiation, so the vote in the Parliament has to be 6 months at least before the end of the two-year deadline, so the working assumption is 16 to 18 months from March. If that is voted down, then two things can happen. One is, well, three things, actually. The first is that the period of negotiations could be extended if we have the goodwill of the EU27. We do not have the goodwill of the EU27. The second option is that the UK falls off a cliff, economically speaking, possibly socially and culturally as well, and constitutionally, which would be, frankly, horrendous for a number of reasons. And go through the cost. There was an estimate today in The Guardian. They're doing a series at the moment on the Brexit gamble, they call it, some 6 billion extra in tariffs for our exporters, some 9 billion, this is per year, some £9 billion paid by us consumers on imported goods from the European Union. Potential saving elsewhere, but effectively a flood of cheap goods from elsewhere outside the EU, which will, of course, swamp domestic production and ruin our industries. So it's not great. The third option, of course, is that the UK pulls back, and there is a court case going through at the moment to see whether or not Article 50 is irrevocable. My gosh, I'm out of time. Which means that, of course, that could be the end of the process there. But that is up for discussion. So, given I'm out of time and I'm 2 points down my 9 list of points here, let me...
You timed this 7
I timed it perfectly. I timed it absolutely perfectly.
You'll have plenty of time.
Let me wrap up very quickly then by saying, look, the ball is in their court. There is a kind of popular opinion that somehow this is going to be a nice, you know, negotiation between two equal partners that sit down in a table, on the, you know, around a table. The UK says, well, we want X. The EU says, well, we want Y. And we come up with a nice compromise. The reality, of course, is that once we trigger Article 50, the ball is entirely in their court. This then becomes a discussion amongst the EU27 about what they want. We have heard today from the government that they've said it's economically irrational for the EU to make trade between us much harder. Well, on the face of it, that's true, but this is a set of rules that being in a club dictates to its members. It's as simple as that. If you leave a club and you want the benefits of that club, you have to follow the rules. And if everybody left the club, still had the benefits but didn't follow the rules, there wouldn't be a club. So that's the kind of basic logic that we're in. And it's something that I don't think the government is being honest with. And we need an honest discussion. And I hope, and I'm sure, that the the House of Commons and the House of Lords will be able now to articulate that through the negotiation phase. But let me stress again, it's in their court, and it's the European Union now that holds all the cards.
Thank you very much. Okay, Davor Jancic.
Thanks very much. It is a great pleasure to be here. And I would like to make one main message for you, and that is that Brexit is a very parliamentary affair. And it is a very parliamentary affair because almost any parliamentary bodies that exist within the EU are involved. That means the UK Parliament is involved in the triggering of Article 50, which is the point at which the UK Parliament has most power. It has least power at the end, as we have said, when the deal has already been negotiated. All the political burden of frustrating the deal is on Parliament, whereby it loses its power. Now, the reason why the UK Parliament has to approve the triggering of Article 50 is because the UK Parliament is the only institution in the UK that can make and unmake all law. So that means the UK Parliament let the EU law in, and it has to be the institution that lets EU law out. That is the reasoning behind the Supreme Court's judgment in the Miller case. Now, the second point that I want to make is that Parliament will also have a constitutional right based on Section 20 of the Constitutional Reform and Governance Act of 2010 to approve or veto the final deal. But that will be a difficult thing to achieve, potentially. Now, the second thing is that the European Parliament will have the right to consent to any deal that is reached, if any is reached at all. And Parliament does mean business. The European Parliament has already rejected some international agreements negotiated by the EU, such as the first SWIFT agreement, which is Terrorist Finance Tracking Program Agreement with the US, ACTA, multilateral ACTA, and anti-counterfeiting trade agreement. And it has also sent the PNR agreements, passenger name records agreements, with the US and Canada to the Court of Justice for vetting for compliance with the EU treaties. So the European Parliament is a serious actor, and also Manfred Weber, who is the leader of the European People's Party, the largest political grouping in the European Parliament, has promised that the European Parliament will be a very difficult partner in the negotiations. The very fact that the European Parliament has its own Brexit negotiator, and mind you, the international agreements are negotiated by the Commission, not by Parliament. The fact that the European Parliament has its own negotiator tells you about the institutional power that the European Parliament enjoys. But what is the role of other national parliaments in the EU, so the French, German, Italian, and so on? This is something that many people do not consider. I think that because the government's white paper on Brexit mentions CETA so prominently and takes it kind of as an example of how the UK free trade agreement could look like, and CETA is a mixed agreement, I think that because any Brexit deal will be even more comprehensive and even more frictionless, as the UK government calls it, will also require the approval of national parliaments of the EU member states. This can prove problematic. There are a number of elections coming in the Netherlands, Germany, and so on. So one cannot easily predict what will happen. We have also seen the opposition of the Walloon Parliament in Belgium against CETA. So there might also be some regional parliaments within member states that may have a thing or two to say in this process. Mind you, for instance, I looked at some of the reports made by other parliaments, and the French National Assembly and the French Senate have adopted extensive reports on Brexit, and I think it was the Senate that has said in a recent report, I think it was published on the 15th of February, they said Brexit is a matter for Brits, the European awakening is a matter for Europeans, we cannot allow Brexit to take European integration project hostage, so we cannot allow Brexit to thwart the future of the European project. So there is already a degree of antagonism and a little bit of muscle flexing among national parliaments already at this stage, even though we don't have any text of any potential deal. And that's the first part of my intervention. The second one is the argument about taking back control of our laws. Now, this is not really so, and there are two reasons why. One is the Great Repeal Bill. The purpose of the Great Repeal Bill is, first of all, to entrench EU law in UK law. Sorry?
Not to repeal.
Yes, actually it is quite the opposite. It permanences EU law in the UK legal system for the time being. So if UK Parliament wants to change that state of affairs, it has to act. But the default position is that the EU law becomes UK law permanently and constantly. So the second thing is the extensive use of so-called Henry VIII clauses, which allow the government to adopt secondary legislation for the purpose of amending or repealing primary legislation. The reason why this is included is because in the 44 or 43 years of the British membership of the EU, there is so much EU law that has become a part of UK law that Parliament simply doesn't have time to repeal, amend, or or change all that law that has become directly available to private parties in the UK to rely on to defend their interests and protect their rights. So that's why the government is intended to be given the right to amend UK legislation. So therefore, it's not Parliament that's going to be making all of that law. Much of it will be made by the government, not by Parliament. And the final thing that I wanted to mention is the fact that when UK leaves the EU, it also leaves a partnership club where international standards are made. So the UK will have to face certain requirements in exchange for access to a degree of access to the single market, if anything of that sort is agreed, which will be imposed by the EU. So that's one. And two is that many international standards, for instance, for financial stability, are adopted by international forums, where now the UK will no longer be the EU's partner, but will be on the other side of the table and will have to compete against the leverage and clout of EU 27. So it isn't a kind of a negotiation between two equal partners. It is a negotiation between one and 27 partners. So that's the thrust of my intervention. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I just want to also thank all of the panel for their input today. However, two of our members, Baroness Ludford and Tasmina Ahmed-Sheikh, have to leave and go back to their day jobs. And considering what we're talking about, it's pretty important. So has anyone got burning questions for either of our two female panellists? Please go ahead.
It's Masato Kimura, Japanese freelance. My question to Seth.
No, I'm sorry. We have to do to the two ladies first because they're about to leave. So has anyone got a question for either Tasmina or Sarah? Yes, go ahead.
Just a quick question for Tasmina. Just a quick question for Tasmina. Given the vote in Gibraltar, I wondered if the Scottish government was in any kind of negotiations with Gibraltar.
I'm not aware of Scottish government negotiations with Gibraltar, but one of our amendments we tabled was we thought that Gibraltar should be part of the whole process, which isn't. Even in the we had a clause in terms of the territorial extent of it, which should extend to Gibraltar, but that again was knocked out as apparently unnecessary, although I think it probably is.
Okay, thank you.
Well, the lady behind, first of all. Thank you.
So I have a question for Baroness Ludford. You say that the Parliament, actually, Brexit start with democracy and should go back in this way. I'm pretty shocked about this, especially because the referendum has been considered, not really, it has been voted by people fully aware of what they were voting. Are you sure it's the best way to do that? Most of the people...
Are you sure that the people who voted, 17 million people who all had individual motivations, but I don't believe that they all did so on the basis of knowing exactly where we were going to end up, because there was no one single narrative from the Leave campaign, because they couldn't agree on it, as to what would happen. So we opened the door to Leave, myriad possibilities of where you can go. You can buy a ticket to anywhere. What I think is the role of Parliament is A, to try and shape the choices, and B, then to hand back the final choice to the voters. So that I don't believe that there was a clear vote last year on the destination. It wasn't on the ballot paper. The destination wasn't on the ballot paper. So that's what should be on another ballot paper.
Thank you for your question. This lady here. One second,
Julia Rampin from The New Statesman. I've got a question for Tasmina, just following on from the first one. Are there any plans for a coordinated strategy between Scotland and Northern Ireland and London, for example? And also, if there is going to be an end to the patience of the Scottish negotiators, when will that moment be?
Oh gosh, if I could give you the answers to all those questions. From the perspective of joint negotiations, Northern Ireland and Scotland, we both sit round the joint ministerial committee table, meet with David Davis, Secretary of State, and Theresa May, and Mike Russell is our representative on that, and Nicola Sturgeon also sometimes. So that is the forum currently for those negotiations. As far as London is concerned, I know Nicola Sturgeon's met with Sadiq Khan, the Mayor of London, and they've had discussions as well. And I think as far as what happens next, we are really waiting, and this is, you know, matter of fact, for the government to confirm what their position is in relation to our document, Scotland's Place in Europe. Are they going to agree to a differentiated agreement for Scotland? And if not, then a decision will require to be taken.
OK, Baroness Ludford wants
I venture with some trepidation into the Scottish debate, but I would just refer you to the speech by my colleague Malcolm Bruce in second reading yesterday. I think my party's position is that Scotland, which still has most of its trade within the UK, is best off within the UK. However...
I have to come back on that.
I leave that there. And as a former London MEP and Islington resident former councillor, I am clearly extremely concerned about the fate of London. And it just shows the inadequacies of our quasi-federal system, one of the many weaknesses of the British or UK constitution is the unevenness and the fact that London has no, if you like, constitutional role. But then I probably would get reverberations within my party if I
press that point too far as well. But although we're doing the ladies, I'm going to let Seb come in on that.
Yeah, no, just on the London point, I mean, I'm not going to get into the independence question, but I can certainly, I think we'll all agree that the structures within the UK just don't allow that proper discussion for... different nations and regions to properly have their voice. And I would say, London, with a population 9.5 million, with the GDP it has, it deserves a distinct role and certainly a seat at the negotiation table. But I think the same, incidentally, about the UK Youth Parliament as well, because young people are not having a voice in this process and they're the ones most affected. So I think there's deficiencies in the system all around.
Tasmin. Just to quickly dispel this trade myth argument, which we hear so often. The actual matter of fact is that the rest of the United... We have a very good trading relationship, and long may it continue. It's important to say that, first of all, between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. But as a matter of fact, the rest of the United Kingdom exports more to Scotland than Scotland exports to the rest of the United Kingdom. And Scotland is the UK's biggest export market in the EU and the second biggest export market in the world. So... And our biggest trading, our growth areas, I've said already in my earlier remarks, is the EU, not the United Kingdom. But any suggestion that the rest of the United Kingdom are going to say, we're not going to trade with Scotland anymore, just as a act of spitefulness, is quite ridiculous. And if that is the attitude they're going to take to the EU when negotiating trade agreements, then heaven forfend the position we're going to find ourselves in. It is absolutely possible for everyone to remain friends and do what's in the best interest economically of the nations of the United Kingdom and, of course, our relationships with the rest of the United Kingdom. And I think it's folly and I think it's irresponsible to suggest that anything else would be the case.
Thank you. No, we've still got a few minutes left, so if anybody's got more burning questions for the ladies. This lady here, yeah. I'll just wait for the microphone. Just one second.
I'm not sure you can answer the question yet, but which amendments, in your views, may pass or in the several days, in the next days, and which amendments will the Lords across the bench put their efforts on? And, well, if you can answer... I mean, what would be the main amendments where your efforts will be... your energy will be on.
Sorry, I didn't quite understand the reference to the crossbenchers because the crossbenchers, the independents in the Lords, who are a very considerable group, obviously I can't speak for them because I'm a Liberal Democrat.
Yeah, I mean, in so general, which amendments do you think?
Well, I mean, we've got three top priorities plus sort of several others which are also important, which are a referendum, the saying the single market... and preserving, guaranteeing rights of EU nationals and and Brits abroad, and others are also equally important, like avoiding a hard border within Ireland. But I have no idea, and it would almost be tempting fate to try and anticipate which we'll get. I think it's safe to say that on the experience of the last few months, the one that gets most comment and sort of vocalisation of support is the EU nationals, as the guarantees of EU nationals, unilateral guarantee, which would not undermine the rights of Brits abroad. It would trigger as a catalyst to reciprocity. It would be throwing goodwill into the pot and would be inconceivable if it was not reciprocated. In the words, which I will no doubt pronate again today, of Lord Michael Howard, the former leader of the Conservative Party. So I think that one, if I was a betting woman, which of course I'm not, possibly I might think that that might have the best chance. And I really, really hope that if that one is passed in the Lords, that that would allow the Commons to say, hey, you know, guys, those people up the other end, they might have a point. And have the courage to pass that one.
Just before we say goodbye to our two esteemed ladies on the panel, can I ask you one quick question, just a quick answer, if you don't mind? You've been in the Lords, obviously, yesterday, and you're going to be there for hours. What's the mood like? What are people saying? Is there optimism? Is there despair? Is there frustration? What would you say it's like?
All of those. I mean, I would say that there is some... sounds a little invidious of me, but sort of gung-ho optimism from certain quarters, not unassociated with the other side of the chamber from me, i.e. the government side. And I would say some of that is whistling in the wind, quite honestly. And, you know, everything will be fine in the best of all possible worlds. We know the narrative, the people have spoken, therefore there is absolutely nothing further that we have to say as Parliament, and I've dealt with that point. Then, I mean, there is passion from my side of the House. When I say my side, in the Liberal Democrats, I'm proud to say we are the focus of the most attacks, vehement attacks from the Tory back benches, and I suspect from the front bench when we get to tonight. Will be directed towards the Liberal Democrats. We had Lord Forsyth, Michael Forsyth, Lord Nigel Lawson yesterday. They sit right opposite me. And that's why I'm wearing red today, because I'm going to sock it to them. we do tend to attract this feeling. But I think there's passion. You know, there's at least as much passion on the side of people saying, hey, let's really think about the disaster, potential disaster, that the extreme Brexit that this government has chosen could be heading towards, and let's really reflect and evaluate and give the people the chance. Let's pay them the respect of saying, we hear what you say last year. You voted by a majority, slim majority, but a majority, to leave. But we're going to, in partnership with you, tease out all the implications and make sure that the government, when it comes back, gives you the chance of the final say. And I think, you know, there's certainly passion about that from my benches, and there's passion from other people, and some indeed on the Patience Week conferences on the Tory side yesterday, about how we cannot just sit on our hands and allow what many people think is a potential disaster just to happen. There was Peter Mandelson yesterday from Labour benches and others. I think that the atmosphere is charged.
Yeah. So passion in the Lords.
Yes.
So it's been to the
Commons. There's life in the old so-and-so's yet.
So you must be watching really carefully now. With the same passion, I'm assuming?
Yeah, I mean, I really hate to get party political, but it will remain a disappointment for us in the SNP, and I'm sure for many in the Labour Party, how the Labour Party were unable to get themselves together on this issue. in the Commons. And I can't help but say there will be a sense of responsibility that will be a cloud over the head of those at the top of the Labour Party in relation to where we are now. Because there was a real opportunity. I mean, Jeremy Corbyn tweeted after in voting to invoke Article 50 that this is the start of the fight. No, it was too late. We had our chance to give passion speeches on the floor of the House of Commons so the electorate could hear that nobody was trying to say we weren't going to do what they wanted us to do, but that it should be approached with reason and understanding and knowledge. Because, no, as you quite rightly said, Baroness, it's not the case that there was a unified position of what Brexit meant. It's not the case that that meant leaving the single market. It's not the case that that meant leaving the European Economic Area. We had a chance to make those points and for the public to have confidence in parliamentarians to take this forward in the right manner. And that's been lost. And I'm afraid the Labour Party are going to have to take a huge amount of responsibility for this. So as we move forward, unfortunately, we feel so powerless because we lose the strength of what could be a united opposition at such an important point in the history of the UK. And what that means will remain to be seen, but the passions remain high. I know what it's like to be shouted at in the House of Commons. It seems to be that Tory men reserve all of their energy, certainly for me and some women on the benches.
To be fair, it's all Liberal Democrats.
We generally get it, but we have to continue to stand up for what we believe in. And as I've said on the floor of the House of Commons before, Parliament must and always be a forum where our voices can be heard democratically, and we must raise our voices and not let others who would seek to do so drown us out.
Thank you very much. So can you give your appreciation to Baroness Sarah Ludford and Tasmina Ahmed-Sheikh, who unfortunately have to leave us. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, ladies. Thank you. Do you want to come in now?
Federalist. And so what is the real sentiment in European Parliament? If possible, second question is German car industry. They export a lot of cars to UK. Mm-hmm. And so real negotiator, I think, is Angela Merkel against Theresa May. And in Germany, politics and car industry is the same entity. How do you evaluate such kind of political and economic dynamics in German car industry politics?
Thank you. Yeah, well, on the Verhofstadt question, he's the point person for the Parliament in the whole negotiation process. So Parliament is the junior partner when it comes to the European institutions. There's no question of that. And the member states will be the ones leading the process. It'll effectively be the council that drives the direction, and the commission will obviously be the facilitators. But the Parliament's consent at the end of the process is what's needed, and that's what will give us leverage throughout. And so all of us are kind of trying to meet for Hofstadt. The London MEPs met for Hofstadt, when was it? Just before Christmas, I think, where we made the London point that I was making earlier, that don't just look at this as just the UK with one voice. We know you've heard from the Scottish government. We know you've heard from the Gibraltarian First Minister. Please also hear from us in London as well. And my colleagues as well will be making the case for the cities they represent as well. So Verhofstadt will be, if you like, the channel of the various shades of opinion from within the Parliament. We have a very interesting kind of role to play, not just standing up for the areas we represent, but also standing up for our country. We do want the best deal, obviously, for the UK, but also standing up for European citizens across the board. We represent 500 million citizens as well. So we've kind of got this sort of shaded role, but Verhofstadt, his unenviable task is to weave that together into a common Parliament position. And I think that will be made a lot easier for him by the degree of unanimity that's been shown across all delegations and across all political parties. When it comes to the German car industry, I hear this argument a lot. We import more than we export, therefore it's in their interest to give us a good deal, etc. I think when this process started, there was certainly a lot of goodwill around. For instance, when I emerged from my haze the week after the referendum to go to the European Parliament, with a big sign saying, "We will miss you," which were very sweet. And the German car industry were one of the first off the blocks, if you like, to say, you know, we need a good deal with Britain. We need to make sure that this process works. We don't want any disruption of trade. I'm afraid that bonhomie has effectively evaporated. And it's because of the line that the government's been taking, because of a lot of the rhetoric they've been issuing, which is all along the lines of, if you don't do this, we'll threaten a trade war, we'll lower our taxes, we'll make ourselves more competitive by slashing red tape, etc., etc. It's meaningless, because actually what businesses want is access to the market. But the response by the German car industry and others has been to change their tune. So they originally said to Angela Merkel, we need a deal that's good for Britain. They're now saying, actually, do you know what? The unity of the European Union is more important. The integrity of the single market is more important. And I think they expected the government to approach this negotiation process with a bit more of an open mind as to what the outcome would be. The fact that they've closed off so many options at the outset is forcing the EU27 to do the same. And I'm afraid the German car industry is not going to be lobbying particularly hard for British interests.
I see you nodding a lot at the end there. Jeff, do you want to comment
just
on
in agreement.
That? Just in agreement, OK. Next question. This gentleman here. Why don't you get the microphone, who you are, who you represent, and which panellist.
I'm Adam. It's a question to all of you, although I'm more interested in the political ramifications. You've mentioned CETA as a possible model for Brexit. What happens if any one of these 38 parliaments and regional parliaments says no? Say CETA is in provisional application, and say 10 years down the line, Wallonia or the French Senate says no. What actually happens to that state? And surely there wouldn't even be a vote taken, because the powers that be would never risk such a no, because these things are in implementation until there's an actual no.
Would you like to take that one?
Yes, that's fine. Thanks for the question. Well, basically, if an agreement is provisionally applied and there is a no vote in a parliament, then it cannot come into force. So that is the formal position. So it won't simply enter into force as it was foreseen. However, that is a difficult thing for a parliament to do. First of all, there is simply the forces of parliamentary democracy, whereby the government has to command a majority in the lower house to stay in power. And second is that the entire deal will be thwarted by a minority, because if just one parliament out of a multitude of parliaments wants to reject, then all the other actors, executive and legislative, will come after that parliament and try to persuade them that they shouldn't do so. And that's what we saw with the balloon parliament. So they were complaining, and then there were all sorts of ways, we will interpret the CETA agreement in a way that suits you or something else. So the most likely outcome will be that there will be some kind of compromise or consensus that will give some formal weak concession to the complaining parliament, in a sense. So, yeah, but if that actually happens, simply the agreement won't come into force.
Next question. You've already had a question, haven't you?
Can I add something?
Yes, hang on, Jeff is coming in this one.
I think that there is likely to be the exit agreement and a comprehensive trade agreement will likely be embodied in two different instruments. I think that the two-year guillotine really applies to the exit agreement. I'm not sure of how much content on the long-term trade arrangements can be built into that phase of negotiations. Not much. Certainly the detail will definitely not be in there. But presumably part of the horse trading in the exit agreement will have some relevance to the long-term trade agreement. That's part of the problem here. You do not have enough time to do it in 2 years, but you want to know where the destination is, at least in vague form, when you're negotiating the exit agreement, so that you can come to Parliament and have something to tell them, not just how we settle the debt liabilities and assets and so on. And this is part of the conundrum we're facing.
Yeah, that timing point is key, because, of course, that you can't start any discussions on what the future looks like until you've left. And the Prime Minister said that she wants everything wrapped up in 2 years. It's simply not possible. But the problem that we have in terms of the one kind of plus point on our side, on the UK side, is that nobody wants disruption to existing arrangements if it can be avoided, but by the time we would negotiate something like CETA, many, many years would have elapsed. So the damage is done.
and we're effectively then trying to recreate what we had some time ago in the past. That impetus on their side has disappeared.
Next question. I will come back to you if nobody else has one. Yes, gentleman in the front row here.
Hello, yeah, John Henley from The Guardian. I had a question for Seb and another for Professor King, if that's okay. I wonder, could you... Are the Commission representing the Council and the EU27 on completely the same page as the Parliament? Are there areas specifically where you might see friction between what Barnier is asking for and what Verhofstadt would like to see? And secondly, Professor King, that you said that you mentioned just now that the future comprehensive trade agreement would probably need a second instrument. Could you talk a little bit about the sort of the legalities of a transitional deal, which looks to be very probable? How would actually that be arranged?
Do you want to go first?
Yeah, sure. There will almost inevitably be points of differentiation between not just the Commission and the Council, but obviously the different member states, but also the political groups in the Parliament as well. They will focus really on the detail. It's the fundamentals that there is unanimity on. Namely, if you want to be in a club and have the... Oh, sorry, if you want to have the benefits of a club, then you need to effectively follow its rules. And I suppose it's that kind of solid stance that has caused the government to throw everything up and say, actually, we can't stay in the single market because of that, before they've even sat down. But there will be points of difference, of course. There will be... industries that are lobbying very hard within different member states for particular benefits, if you like, for the arrangement going forward. The problem is, of course, that it's all voted on as a whole at the end. So it's the position of the member states and the position of the parliament. Well, certainly the position of the Parliament has to be united, but the position of the Member States has to be very consistent as well. So all of those points of differentiation, they will come up in the talks, but will they be reflected in the final deal? I think the fundamentals will swamp that. Who knows? Things can change a lot in the next 18 months, but that's the position at the moment. It doesn't look as if we can put too much faith in those differentials.
Jeff.
Thank you. I will shoot slightly from the hip here because I haven't considered this nor read much about the legal technicalities. But one way that it could be done is in the process of the exit agreements that the United Kingdom could commit to maintaining the same regulatory framework and complying with EU rules as embodied in the Great Repeal Bill, and therefore maintain the regulatory compliance with the customs union. And then, while it's bargaining towards a comprehensive trade agreement, then it can start making its plans for how it wants to unpick those regulations one by one under the powers embodied in the Great Repeal Bill. So I think it can legally be done. And I think another thing that could be done is in the exit agreement, there might be, we'll call it sovereignty carve-outs, where it says, we'll generally abide by the terms of EU law, but here are a couple of issues that are really important to us. We can imagine what some of those might be, free movement, for instance. So they might have an interim arrangement which might be accepted that could be embodied in the exit agreement that would generally include the UK in the customs union for the duration of the time required to negotiate the comprehensive trade agreement. The political difficulty is that the duration of that trade agreement will exceed the life of the current parliament, certainly. It might even exceed the life of the next parliament. And then... Well, that's the situation we're in. Mm-hmm.
I just want to bring Davor in on this. Do you think we underestimate the role of EU parliaments in decision-making within the EU?
Certainly, I think so, yes. And I just wanted to come in on that point. I think one way to sort this out is, first of all, we have Article 50, which envisages itself two agreements. One is on divorce, and the other is on trade. So there are two agreements. The second one is potentially more important because the other one is just a way to extricate the UK from the EU. The second one is what will determine the rules of the game. Now, the role of parliaments in that. If you look at some of the agreements that have been negotiated between the EU and its traditional partners, with the US we have TTIP, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership Agreement. There we have provisions for certain bodies for regulatory cooperation. These envisage cooperation between the U.S. federal agencies and the European Commission officials. And there are also provisions for legislative cooperation. So when the U.S. And the EU propose new legislation, there have to be notifications and mutual commenting on legislation, not only on regulation. Regulation is not necessarily legislation. So at the legislative level, there are some exchanges. In CETA, there's also a regulatory cooperation forum, but that one does not envisage any interparliamentary cooperation as TTIP does. But however, we don't know what will happen with TTIP now that there's a new president in the US, so we don't know. And I have actually spoken with the EU Commissioner, Cecilia Malmström, personally at a conference in Sweden. And she told me that, first of all, there was an ambitious body in the terms of a regulatory cooperation council. Then the U.S. was not very keen on that, so then they demoted that to simply a coordinating structure for regulatory cooperation. So now we cannot really say whether that will be retained and in what form. But certainly there is a strong role for parliaments to be crafted in one way or another. And the most important reason, in my view, is the adoption of a legislation unilaterally that has an external effect. That external effect can be extraterritorial. It doesn't have to be, but it can simply be effect. But in case of extraterritorial legislation, whereby external, you know, the third countries are directly affected, then there is a role for legislatures to cooperate to stop that, to prevent disputes, to prevent frictions, because we want a frictionless exit of the UK from the EU. So, that would be my answer.
Thank you. Next question. Gentleman over here in the back.
Yes, I have two questions that are of...
Can you tell us who you are?
Yes, my name is Angelos Monsaridis. I come from Greece, so I'm a bargaining chip. I have two questions of legal nature. The very notion of a meaningful vote after the end of the negotiation means that either the UK government can ask for an extension, which is not necessarily means that it's going to get it, or it should be, or it can ask for a revoke of the Article 50. So I would like to ask, especially the legal experts in the panel, what's the possibility of Article 50 being revocable? I mean, is that even possible? I mean, what's your opinion on that? And the second one is about the Great Repeal Bill, which is not really a Great Repeal Bill, it's a Great Embedding Bill. There are some laws, I don't know the legal terms, that actually have references to European laws. So the law says that so the law can actually implicitly change when the European Parliament actually votes something. So is that probably easy to tackle in the Great Repeal Bill, or how is that possible? I mean, are they actually going to embed a snapshot of the European law, or how does that work?
Okay, a couple of interesting points there. Who would like to take?
Would you like to go first?
I could come in on the revocability of Article 50. The answer is no, it's not revocable. And the reason is, first of all, the Supreme Court says so, and they have been very clear about this. And the second is that also some arguments relying on international law to support revocability of Article 50 do not stand in my view. And that argument is Article 68 of the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, which says that a withdrawal notification can be revoked at any time before it takes effect. But Article 50 notification takes effect immediately. And therefore, it takes effect immediately, and the moment it's triggered, it can no longer be withdrawn. So even based on international law, which is not a suitable way to interpret EU law, because EU law is a separate body of international law, we have to listen to what the ECJ, European Court of Justice, says about EU law, because it is, all the member states have agreed that the European Court of Justice will be the institution that interprets EU law, says so. So that will be my take on the revocability of Article 50. And the second question was about the Great Repeal Bill. The point of that bill is to make EU law part of UK law as it stands on Brexit Day. So whatever is, you know, in the pipeline for implementation, or is otherwise in another way incorporated in UK law stays. But the point is that is static. So it does not make provision for any changes in UK law when EU law changes on the EU side. So that is also an argument about access. I don't want them. They're complicated methods. But there is a. We can talk about that later, about equivalence. And so.
Seb, do you want to say something?
Yeah, just that was a very definitive opinion on Article 50, and thank you.
No, thanks.
No, thanks, but no thanks. No. That may well be the case. Lord Kerr, who wrote it, says it is revocable. But,
I know, there are views there. Yeah. There are different views, of course.
We'll see. What one thing's for certain, you can't, if it were revocable, you couldn't then revoke it just to prolong the negotiations and then 2 weeks later reissue it and start the process again. So there has to be some safeguard against that, certainly, but that safeguard was pretty definitive. In terms of the Great Repeal Bill, of course, there is a misleading name, but actually, as you say, what will happen over time is that the standards will just diverge increasingly. And effectively, there's no other way of the government to do it, otherwise they would be bogged down for years, well, they will be anyway, but on just the existing body of law. So that's why it's there. But, of course, everything can then be repealed with a majority of one in the House of Commons. So one of the things that we said we would protect at European level, workers' rights, environmental protection, et cetera, they could just be undone. And I think Lord Lawson let the cat out of the bag yesterday when he said, finally, we can now get rid of all this restricting red tape that businesses face. But as you say, it's access to the market that they need to compete in. It's not red tape. As such, it enables them to function in the market they need to be in. But if we diverge too much, they won't be able to... Well, if we diverge at all from the rules of that market, we won't be able to sell on the same terms and buy on the same terms.
Jeff was scribbling furiously there.
I'm scribbling furiously. I have this terrible habit when I'm asked questions. So on the meaningful vote point, we have to distinguish between unilateral revocation... And on the one hand, and revocation with the consent of the 27 member states on the other. I take the view that unilateral revocation is not likely to be found by the Court of Justice of the European Union to be possible, precisely because it would undermine the integrity of the European Union if states could give notice under Article 50 and then withdraw it and restart negotiations. Now, the answer to that view is that, well, there's principles like good faith that would allow the court to stop states from using it in this way, and therefore we can accept unilateral revocation provided it's in good faith. That's a strong argument. It's held by leading European lawyers like Tridimas and Craig and Lord Kerr. I don't buy it, though, for the reason that I think it's the EU has the right to say, even if you're in good faith, if your house is not in order, we can insist on the two-year guillotine in this situation. That's why I don't think unilateral revocation is possible, but the point will be tested in a case taken from Ireland. Now, it's not all bad news, though, because the multilateral option is different. So the reason we're having this discussion is, if Parliament has a meaningful say at the end of the process, does it matter? Because the guillotine will come down anyway. It can matter, I think, because no EU law scholar, I think, has suggested that with the agreement of the other 27 member states, you couldn't allow the state to withdraw its notice. And I think that a resolution from Parliament or an act of defiance against the government would play well politically. I don't know, Seb Dance can tell us whether that's wishful thinking to have the other 27 nations agree. I suspect that if you see a sign of commitment to the European project coming from Parliament, they will agree to extend. So it's risky, but it's not meaningless, I think, that option. On the Great Repeal Bill, you say that, rightly, that much of UK law has a real-time integration with what goes on in Europe. I think there are legal techniques for allowing that to continue. One is to have some type of incorporation clause, such as what's under Section 2 of the European Communities Act of 72. That's the current provision that was at the heart of the Supreme Court case. Another might be a power given to the government to use regulations laid before Parliament to enable ongoing reception of the law. So I don't think it's impossible.
Okay, thank you very much for that question. Let's go to this side here, the lady in the front here. I'll try and get through as many as possible, don't worry.
I'm Nalima Fernandez. I'm a private banker in London. although a better introduction would have been I'm a strategy student from University of Oxford. So, this is a question to the panel. Seb would be the most appropriate person for this, but you know, anyone's fine. Considering that, so my question is a two-part one. So first is about progress. Now, considering that EU27 has, such enormous power over the decision and, you know, how it can influence which parts of the terms and conditions they can satisfy and which parts they can just leave out, would the government, or is there an appetite for us, for Britain, to open up international barriers to other countries, so emerging markets, I don't know, in the Far East, or, you know, other potential investors who are probably waiting to sort of invest in Britain. Is there an appetite for that? And also, secondly, is it possible that, because this is such a complex, and I've only sort of probably got into this, you know, understanding this a lot better after this, you know, after listening to the panel this morning. In terms of investor confidence, how do we then simplify all of this to them and say, look, you know, it's not all bad news? What message should we put out there? I'm just being optimistic. I should be in the House of Lords, possibly. How do we simplify it and make sure that, you know, we regain that investor confidence and not have a Trump situation?
Yeah. Well, in answer to your second one, investor confidence could be assured, quite simply by saying we're staying in the single market, even if it's a transition measure. And for the life of me, still can't work out why the government has unilaterally ruled that out without having begun the negotiation process. It certainly should be the position that my party adopts. Disappointed it hasn't got there yet, but I'm confident that some common sense will prevail at some level somewhere, and that somebody will, other than me, will be making the case that the single market is the only sensible place to be, even if it's a transition. In terms of opening up to new markets, that was one of the big points, of course, selling points of the Leave campaign, that we would now be able to open up to other parts of the world. The problem with that is that under the EU, as a member of the EU, we've already been part of that process of opening up to the rest of the world with some 50 trade agreements already in place and others in the pipeline. The simple fact is it's a very slow, laborious, time-consuming, legalistic process, and many of these deals take years and years and years. But one of the things, and actually Tasmina said it in one of her arguments for independence, which I found curiously similar to the arguments that are made by the Leave side, which is that the non-European market is growing and the European market is stagnating. Well, that is the case sometimes, although the Eurozone is now growing again. But actually, it's because other parts of the world that have been poorer for much longer are now becoming richer. It's a good thing. And obviously, as that happens, the European market will shrink as a proportion, but it's still by far our largest market. It's 44%. And Liam Fox was talking about, you know, a deal with Australia. It's 1.4%. So we're throwing away 44% to kind of scrabble together bits and pieces to try and make up that percentage. Well, not only will that take years, when leaving the single market will be instantaneous, but we can't possibly hope to replicate that anytime soon. So we need to hold on to what we've got, even if it's a shrinking share of the world market, it's still our biggest share, before we then start to contemplate how we increase that share elsewhere. I think it should happen. Of course, I would love trade agreements with India, with Southeast Asia, with China. It would be brilliant, fantastic, absolutely. It means it's done properly. It means more investment. It means more jobs. It means higher living standards. But we can't throw away our existing base in order to do it. It doesn't make any sense.
The other part of the question, which was the EU27's power over decisions. Mm-hmm. Do you want to comment on that, or shall I get... You all right? It's yours.
Well, actually, I wanted to make a comment on the investors waiting to invest. They can already invest, and they do. And the EU is negotiating international agreements with all sorts of countries, including those that are part of the Commonwealth, with Australia, but also now recently Singapore and Japan. So the EU takes the lead. So the question about the power of the EU27 is a considerable one. So certainly third countries prefer access to
to a market of 450 million rather than only to the market of 65 million consumers. And I think the UK's best position is well, not right now, but before June last year, because it had a seat at the negotiating table where all those decisions about the EU's internal market were made and decisions about whom to trade with and on what terms to trade. Now, obviously, the UK will, you know, depending on the withdrawal agreement, gain some sovereignty over how it makes international agreements, trade agreements, but it may have to stand in line because the EU is a bigger market simply, and it is a market where there are no barriers. So the whole point of the internal market is there's a free flow of goods and services, which the UK now enjoys, and that is absolutely paramount for the financial services sector. And now how that will be preserved is a metaphor for a different question.
On that note, a different question. Okay, I think this gentleman here, did you want to? And then I'll come over there. Good
morning. My name's Howard Davis, and I represent the European University Association. I'm interested, therefore, in areas of shared competence. And just to come back to the CETA, to the EU-Canada agreement, my understanding of provisional application is that the agreement can be provisionally applied in areas in which the EU has exclusive competence, but not in areas in which it has shared competence. And I can see that that principle would inform the subsequent free trade agreement, if ever there was one, between the UK and the EU. Does it also inform the divorce agreement? That's my question. The distinction between policy areas in which there is shared competence and policy areas in which there is EU-only competence. Is that a principle that informs the divorce discussions? Is it a principle that is informing the current negotiations or the future negotiations? That I would like your opinion on, please.
Who wants to start? Do you want to start?
That's a question of EU law, and I mostly work in British constitutional law, so I'll have to defer to my colleague here.
Well, I think it's a little bit too far ahead for us to speak about that. And the commercial policy, common commercial policy, is an exclusive competence of the EU. And in that respect, it is difficult to compare because they will not be the same agreements. And even the British government has made a point saying that they want to bespoke trade agreements. So it is difficult to draw some kind of parallels with other international agreements. Whether this distinction between exclusive competence and shared competence may apply to divorce proceedings, probably not, because divorce will not be on trade issues. So the CETA agreement with Canada does not deal with any divorce. So that's one distinction. And the second distinction is that the UK and the EU already have regulatory convergence because they're part of the same bloc. So the starting positions of the UK are much stronger than the starting position of Canada because they have a divergent regulatory system. So they have to come together. In the case of the UK and the EU, they don't have to come together because they are already together. And so it is a difficult thing to compare in terms of provisional application. I think provisional application in the case of the UK, when it comes to trade and commerce, will be much easier to achieve than in the case of Canada. So that would be my take on that.
Yeah, just on that point, the discussions with Canada about how to create extra opportunities, how to integrate much more, how to kind of reduce friction, to use the current parlance, whereas obviously what we're talking about when it comes to the UK is how to entwine, how to create more barriers, how to make things harder. And that's the kind of psychological problem that we've got, is that every industry, every sector, every element of, and academia is a very good example, where these networks have been so beneficial. To then have a discussion at sector level about how we break them apart, nobody wants to do that, and nobody wants to go through it with any enthusiasm either. And that, I think, is going to be a tricky kind of psychological space for this to operate in. So I think the CETA comparison is interesting on many levels, but that psychological element of unpicking rather than creating is going to be an interesting one.
Just one more thing on education and the role of universities. I have recently seen information that Canada has overtaken the UK in terms of EU students' interest in studying in their country. So Canada has taken over. So not only are they taking away EU students, they're taking away trade because they've already signed an international trade agreement. And there has also already been a decline of 7% in the number of enrollments of EU students in UK universities. So in my view, that's a significant decline. So we're probably likely to see more of that, unfortunately.
Oh, on that happy note, let's move on to another question. We've got about 10, 15 minutes left. I promise this gentleman over here, and then I'll come back over here. Yeah, don't worry.
Good morning. My name's Tom Clayton. I'm from March for Europe. Question for Seb. with the upcoming French elections in mind, to what extent can we see the European institutions to be responsible for allowing themselves to have become so scapegoated by people with various political agendas in recent times? And what lessons should the EU institutions learn with regards to their own PR in order to preserve the integrity of the EU? And then secondly, if I may, for either of the constitutional experts, we heard a lot from Tasmina about the determination of Scotland to pursue a trajectory that's out of sync with that of the British government. And I wonder, from now that she's not here, from the point of view of a sober constitutional perspective, to what extent, in light of the Sewell, the bypassing of the Sewell Convention in the Supreme Court, to what extent is that just political rhetoric, or does it pose a serious threat to derailing the Brexit process?
Is that first?
Yeah, sure. European elections. We haven't talked about that at all today, but it's a hugely important element in all of this, and it's one of the reasons why Sir Ivan Rogers, the previous perm rep to the European Union from the UK, advised the Prime Minister to wait until September this year before invoking Article 50. Because, simply, we've got the French elections in the spring, the Dutch elections a few weeks' time, and the German elections in September. And actually, the stakes are just astonishing. we've talked about a lot of scary things today, but the French election can go one of two ways. We could have a pro-European, reformist, modernist, pro-immigration, or we could have a far-right National Front, let's face it, a fascist. And if Le Pen wins, the European project is doomed. And if she doesn't win, it's potentially saved. So a lot rides on what happens in France in the spring. And it has implications for us, of course, here. And I've read some astonishing commentary saying, oh, we want Le Pen to win because it makes it easy. If the whole EU project fails, then what we've done looks less nuts. Well, yeah, frankly, I don't want a far-right fascist running a country next door to ours. You know, France is a great nation and it doesn't deserve to fall into the pit of fascism just so it makes us look a little less daft. So there is a lot riding on this. And you're absolutely right. What's happened, of course, is that many of the problems that people face now, and they're very varied and complicated, mostly to do with technological change. And the automation in jobs, the fact that jobs are less secure, the fact that you can no longer depend on a job for life and the benefits that accrue to it and so on and so forth. And it's been very easy and it's been done very effectively in this country, as we've seen, of course, but it's been being copied in other member states. It's very easy to say, well, that's Europe. You know, that's not nothing to do with my failing as a domestic politician. That's to do with the European Union because, you know, X, Y, Z, and you kind of blame the other, and the European Union is that kind of convenient scapegoat. It's been much less effective in other countries, but they've copied the technique, and it's now starting to reap dividends. And you know, we have failed, I think, as pro-European politicians to make the case for the benefit of Europe successively. My party, I don't think, has done enough. The Tory party, you know, clearly hasn't done enough. Even the Lib Dems, I say, I think we've all failed at some level to do that, and we have to put our hands up. It's not too late. Now's the time to kind of make the case and the fight back. But it's that exploitation of fears and the easy scapegoating that we see all across Europe, and we've got to guard against it, firstly, but secondly, call it out. We can't just sort of avoid the subjects that we don't want to talk about because we think that they're more confident speaking on those terms. We have to march into that territory. We have to go where the Front National are. We have to go where UKIP are. We have to go where the hard right is and say, I'm sorry, but what they're telling you is why I held up this sign, incidentally. What they are telling you is a lie. And all of the solutions they are coming up with are fake solutions. They are sticking plaster. They're nothing to do with the real problem. And we've got to articulate that. But we've got to start doing it now. And all this triangulation that's happened for so long has just got to stop. And we can't nuance our arguments anymore.
Jeff, constitutionally?
Yes, thank you. So to what extent does Scotland have the constitutional power to derail Brexit? I believe its powers are very limited. So the Sewell Convention is a convention that says that the UK Parliament may not normally legislate on matters within devolved competence without the consent of the Scottish Parliament. So the first problem here with trying to use that convention to insist on a legislative consent motion in the Scottish Parliament is that foreign affairs is a reserved matter for the UK Parliament. The second problem is it is not a normal situation. The third problem is it's a political convention, which ultimately can be disregarded. And if ever there were a context in which that power would be exercised, it would be this one. So the Sewell Convention, the court made it clear it is not binding as a legal matter, but they left open that it could be as a political matter. If that sounds strange, it is. But nevertheless, that's not the end of the story again. Here's why. So it is a triggering event for a second independence referendum. It used to be the case that part of the problem for Scotland is if they sought independence, they would have a very hard time being admitted into the European Union because there are other nations which have separatist right. But now the UK is leaving the European Union. So independence for Scotland could very well be a very sweet deal for the rest of the European Union. And now I think the independence movement, which has some extraordinarily good politicians in it, we've seen here today, I think they're going to be in the strongest position they've been for a long time. And that is a threat to the union, which is terrible, I think.
Davor, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I fully agree with both comments. And I just wanted to add an EU law perspective. And that is that potentially the rise of populism is so striking because national parliaments acting at the national level have had a very marginal role throughout European integration. Even with the Treaty of Lisbon, there is an early warning mechanism whereby national parliaments can send reasoned opinions where they think that draft EU legislation infringes the treaties and violates subsidiarity. So then they can submit reasoned opinions. But even that can only have any legal effect at the EU level if it reaches a threshold of one-third or one-half of the votes allocated to national parliaments. And each parliament has two votes. So it's really difficult to effect any outcomes at the EU level. So the reason why national parliament can basically cannot be held accountable for what they do and say is because they have no say. So this is the reason why, I mean, one of the reasons why former Prime Minister David Cameron wanted to introduce the so-called red card procedure and give national parliaments a veto, outright veto over draft EU legislation that failed because there was a vote to leave the EU. But there is a strong case there to do something about parliaments because all the other national institutions have been entrenched in the European Union. So we have courts acting as courts of the EU, implementing decisions of the European Court of Justice. Governments are the key actors in the EU. Parliaments are still in search of a role. And so I think that is an area where more attention needs to be paid. So therefore, this gathering is very relevant.
A lady over here. Going to have to be the last question.
Hello, everybody. My name is Eugenia. I'm a freelance journalist and PR consultant. I just wanted to be on the practical side and ask you about British passports. I understand that we are going to replace our European Union passports with British passports in 2019, probably 2 years from the Article 50 thing. And I also read that European Parliament came up with an initiative to suggest that those British citizens who want to maintain their European passports, they may do so. Is it just wishful thinking of the authors of the articles, or there was really such initiative?
Who wants to take that question?
Should I give a political? Before it's shot down by the constitutional experts, I'll give the political. The passports, gosh, yeah, it's all worth it because we'll get blue passports. I mean, whether they're blue or red, I don't think particularly matters. But I must remember to renew mine before 2019 so I get the European Union on it. The associated citizenship proposal is something that was proposed by an MEP on behalf of Verhofstadt. So Verhofstadt was actually the person who first thought it up. And that's good news because, obviously, as the Parliament's lead negotiator, it means that there is somebody right at the heart of it who understands that European citizenship is not just a kind of technicality. It infers a number of rights on each and every one of us who is a European citizen. And we should value them, and we haven't talked about them at all in the referendum campaign. The government's certainly not interested in flagging them up as potential areas of the negotiation process. Incidentally, that's something I hope that the media does going forward. What the associated citizenship would effectively... The principle behind it is people who are currently European citizens who don't want to be deprived of their European citizenship have the right to retain it. It's a simple principle. The problem is that we are coming up against the rhetoric from the UK government, which effectively means that we are asking our partners to confer on British citizens an additional right, which would be at their behest, if you like. And although the principle is a strong one, we need to make sure that we have a lot more goodwill from our partners to ensure that they would be even willing to consider that as a concession. It also means, of course, that they're saying if you're a British citizen who gets European citizenship, you effectively can partake in all the benefits, including, of course, competing with our own citizens when it comes to certain sectors that Britain is particularly competitive in. And that will be a key kind of red light for many to consider. I have to say I think it's unlikely, unfortunately. But it doesn't mean that we won't fight tooth and nail for it, because I think that initial principle is an important one. And people are being deprived of something they value that it's right to put up a defence for. So we will.
And constitutionally?
I think I will, in this case, allow ignorance to prevent me from offering a strong view.
What about yourself?
Well, I would like to add, I assume the question is about travelling. And that's a minor issue. I think traveling can be easily agreed. No borders, we can just travel all around, tourism and things like that. That's not a problem. I'm not a new national, but I can travel around the EU if I want to for 3 months. But the whole point of EU citizenship is not necessarily only about traveling. It is about much more. It is about the right to vote in local elections. It is about the right to the diplomatic and consular protection by other member states abroad. It is about entitlement to social security benefits of certain sorts. It is about the right to freely establish yourselves as a business in other member states. So those are the rights that come together with EU citizenship. And EU citizenship complements national citizenship. So it is a little bit of a far-fetched thing to guarantee something in advance that is such a multifarious thing. So EU citizenship encompasses many things and gives a lot of rights. This is why it is a very good thing to be an EU citizen, because it allows you to do many more things than just national citizenship, even though it is just a complementary kind of citizenship. So I think this would be a really difficult thing to argue that all of these rights are granted to people who have voted out. So there will be a strong argument against that on the part of the populace in other member states who are simply not happy with the decision. So it is not an easy argument to win.
And I think that's a very good place to leave it. I would like you really to show your appreciation for our panel today, because they have been fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. We hope also that we managed to do what we said we'd do at the beginning, stimulate conversation, talk about the role of parliaments, move this entire conversation on. It's not the last time we're going to be talking about it, is it? Thank you all very much for coming. Thank you.